Hi, welcome back to our series on calibration. I'm Bob Stern, Senior Metrologist at Agilent Technologies. In this module on standards compliance, we're going to be looking at some of the key calibration standards, starting with 17025, ILAC G8, the guidelines on reporting, which gives you further guidance on 17025, and several others, most notably ILAC P14, which came out just in 2010 and has some important guidelines for those people who need accredited calibrations. Here's where we are in the series. We're in module number 5, and you can see the other ones. If you haven't seen those already, numbers 2 and 3 would be especially appropriate for this module. Obviously, the question for this module is, what standards do you want to comply with? Well, probably the most important calibration standard for calibration laboratories is 17025, and you can get an idea of the importance of that just from the title of the document. General requirements for the competence of testing and calibration laboratories. Very important as part of the interpretation and implementation of 17025 is the ISO GUM, and that was what we covered in Module 3. In this module, we'll also be taking a close look at how do you figure out what's a pass and what's a fail. And many people do that by making use of ILAC G8, which is another important document, and you see several more. So before we get into the specifics on the standards, I just want to make a statement that calibration standards are not perfect. So although all the people that are on the standards committees try their best, these standards are created by human beings. And the end result, especially with the international standards, is that sometimes you're just not able to agree. What I just want to call to your attention is that both the Z540-1 or 17025 both have paragraphs on very important topics with, unfortunately, non-specific wording, and the result is they're fairly open to interpretation. And that actually results in sometimes wide variations in what specific calibration laboratories do. We're telling you this only so that you'll be educated and you'll understand what the possibilities are, and you'll be able to ask anyone that you're considering for your calibration business, you'll know what to expect and the kinds of questions you should ask. Let's start with 17025. One of the critical paragraphs there is 510.42, which says, when statements of compliance are made, the uncertainty of measurement shall be taken into account. There are all kinds of variations on this. Sometimes you hear, yep, we did that. I've got our test accuracy right here. We're all set. Well, I'm here to tell you that test accuracy ratio, as defined in the early 80s in the MIL standard 45662, is not the same as measurement uncertainty and should not be construed as such. In fact, for those of you that are in a European audience or in the Far East, many of your accreditation bodies enforce that paragraph as saying, use expanded measurement uncertainty as per ILAC G8 that we'll be looking into in a minute, and use that and guard band it. So there are variations across regions, and so when you hear someone say, oh, we meet 17025, you need to ask some additional questions. Hopefully by the end of this module, you'll be comfortable to know what those are. Now, we want to go back to the test point labeling challenge that we looked at earlier on. If it's way out of spec, we all know that's a fail. If it's way inside, that's a pass. So really the question is, what do you do when the measurement uncertainty crosses the specification? And that's really what ILAC G8 is all about. Look at the title once. There's a link at the bottom. You can download it. It's free. It's only about 10 pages long. Guidelines on the reporting of compliance with specification. Let me just stress that at Agilent Technologies, what we try to do is to meet all the standards so that you never have to worry. So we dive in a little bit here to that document, the little areas in red, which you can't see yet. I'm going to zoom in a little bit. And now you can see this is one of the key paragraphs, which you really have to look at if you're going to be considering these standards. And basically what they're saying in here, in fact, we're going to zoom in even more. So look at case 2. This is the same as the diagram that I was showing earlier. The measured result is inside the specification, but a portion of the 95% expanded uncertainty is outside. And what ILAC G8 says is that you may not claim that that's a pass. You can say that it is observed to pass, but you cannot say that with a corresponding 95% coverage probability. At Agilent, we've changed the names of our services and we've lined up the deliverables to meet up with these standards. I want to show you what we do for our service, Agilent Cal plus uncertainties. So in case two, which is the same one we've been looking at, you can look at the wording here, and I invite you to either pause or, you know, look at this a little bit later on. The wording maybe seems a little bit formal to you, but there's a reason for that. We never want to hear from our customers which part of this paragraph does Agilent not understand. So we've just finished a long project where top metrologists from all over Agilent have had all of these standards open, and we were studying these to make sure that when we use a pass or fail designation that we're absolutely in alignment with these standards, that the accreditation bodies agree, and of course we checked with customers to make sure that they were fine with that too. So this is noted as a passed, but it has the double dagger symbol, which means as observed, you passed, but you might want to look at this a little bit further because a portion of the expanded uncertainty is outside the spec. Similarly, in the case where you observe it to fail, in other words, it's as observed, it's outside the spec, but a portion of the measurement uncertainty is also indicated in that. We have similar wording, which we have on the left. And again, you'll notice that we line those up with the key paragraphs in either 17025 and ILAC G8. So when 17025 says measurement uncertainty shall be taken into account, you'll know exactly how we've done that with Agilent because we've lined it up and we make it very precise for you. You might have noticed that there was a service called Agilent Cal plus uncertainties plus guard banding. And so this one is pass, fail, or in the case of either the case two or case three that we were just looking at from the standard, whereas where you measure just inside or just outside, but it crosses. In that case, the standard says you should really call that undetermined. So you can't say whether it passed or failed. Now clearly we report the measurement result. So any customer wants to know, was I in or was I out? As measured, you'll be able to see that on our measurement report. But in terms of the designation, did you pass or did you fail, the standard says that you really should report undetermined. So we do with this service. Some of our more demanding customers say, when it's sent back to me, I don't want to see any of those F double daggers, or I don't want to see the U for uncertain. Well, that's fine. We understand that. And that's really what a guard band is all about. So a guard band is really just simply the offset from the specification that determines the acceptance limit for pass or fail decisions and where we perform adjustments. So if you put all of this together, this is the way that we're designating pass or fail in the various services that we offer. Now, some of this work was just recently completed and we're still busy implementing these. So if you receive a report, you may not necessarily receive all of these exact designations. But within a year, this is what you'll see. Finally, I want to talk a little bit about the ILAC policy for uncertainty in calibration. Notice that this is a policy document, so it's a very strong in terms of, you know, it's not just a guide, but it's a policy. And this is what dictates what accreditation bodies, the rules that they have to follow. Now we're going to zoom in to one of the critical paragraphs that's in paragraph 6 area. And what paragraph 6 says is that accredited calibration laboratories shall report the uncertainty of measurement in compliance with the requirements, and then they have several paragraphs. Bottom line is, everything we talked about in section 3 of the series, the measurement uncertainty, you must include that, you must report that if you want to include the symbol on the calibration certificate. And you see some of the accreditation bodies that follow these guidelines. So in order to meet all of these calibration standards, what we have done is rearranged all of our calibration services so that you can see at a single glance which standards are met, by simply determining, do you need uncertainties reported? Do you need guard banding? This is probably a good point for me to also let you know that even if you don't select one of our services that has the uncertainties reported, you should know that at Agilent, we do not change the way we do the performance tests. This is really important because sometimes if you look at some of the lower cost calibration offerings available, what will happen is you'll get a functional test instead of real tests, or you'll get a subset of tests or something like that. At Agilent, when I said before, we do every test, every option, every time. What you can deduce from this is that we know that our uncertainties are low or reasonable because we develop those when we do the procedure. And at the same time, if you select the Agilent calibration, no, you won't receive the reported uncertainties, but it'll still be the exact same procedure using the same instruments. And even though the uncertainty is not reported, it is in fact the same. In that last chart, you can click on your region to see slightly different variations of those. That concludes our module on standards compliance. Hope this was useful, and I hope to see you back on our module on accreditation shortly. Thank you very much.